Thank you. It is a story that you need to hear. That's the end time message. It's all the music, praise and worship. But also, it's a very special bonus gift with your purchase of this CD-DVD combo, Sound from Heaven. You're going to receive Dad's music CD entitled The Healing Jesus. Absolutely free as a bonus gift with every purchase. Now, you can see the address on the screen, or it's easier to go online. You can see that address as well. Don't miss out on this special offer.
If you're looking for a great school in Baton Rouge, we'd like you to consider Family Christian Academy. Tuition costs are very competitive. FCA offers the Abeka curriculum for K-4 through 5th grade and does not teach Common Core. FCA is an ACT testing site and offers honors and advanced placement courses. Discover Family Christian Academy. Call 225-768-3026 or visit fcacademy.net.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Pastor Gabriel Swearer. We have got a very special item. An item, I should say, for parents who have young children. If you're looking for a very interesting and cool way to share the Word of God with them, then why not purchase at $5 each our Color Me a Bible Story coloring books featuring several different Bible stories. Throughout each one, you can color your way with 48 hand-drawn coloring and activity pages. This is featuring, of course, Noah and the Flood, Ruth, Abraham and Sarah, Jonah and the Well, and several others. $5 each. Mom and Dad, you need to get these for your kids. Grandparents, get them for your grandkids. They will enjoy it. Call the number right now on the screen. You can go online and pick up these items.
The live album, Take Me Through This Valley, from Family Worship Center Resurrection singer, Martha Bull.
Take me through this valley, and
draw me close to you. Praise the Lord with this beautiful collection of songs. Jesus Christ. To order the album, Take Me Through This Valley from Martha Ward, go to shopjsm.org.
The call of God is the highest calling on the face of the entire earth.
I would encourage you to prayerfully consider becoming a part of World Evangelism Fellowship. If you're a pastor, an evangelist, a teacher, and you believe in the message that we preach on Sunlight Broadcasting Network, the message of the cross, and you're not affiliated with any organization, please prayerfully consider becoming a part of World Evangelism Fellowship.
It's God who has called you. You did not call yourselves.
Whether you're a pastor, an evangelist, whether you're a teacher, whether you're working in prisons as a chaplain, and you believe in what we stand for and you want to join them, you can go online on our website and download all the information. It's World Evangelism Fellowship.
In a 60-year history, Jim Swagger Ministries has received millions of letters and emails from believers who have questions about Christian life and living. In response to these questions, Brother Swagger has written a Here Is My Question series. In this first book of the series, he answers many questions Christians ask, taken directly from the Word of God that needs to be more prevalent among believers today. To purchase this book,
happens. They don't have no mics, so they're just complaining. But it don't matter, it's like... Jesus.
Somebody said once that they had no trouble with the devil. Well, get saved and you will.
Lord, I love when he said that. It's so true. He don't oppose, but don't bother again. Thank you, Pastor. Got that from you.
This is what it says.
She used God's name in vain with filthy words. What's foolish? They want to put you in everything, but what's right? Well, I don't know him. I can't say he didn't go to see the Lord. Let God heal him, man. He's a lovely alive, boy. I see your ex-husband.
It's
not. But you remind me of a neighbor. Sucky Lord, for years, she reminded me of a neighbor. And now she didn't cut her hair. Well, I wouldn't even call it color, but go ahead. Lord, you know I'm not lying. Never, ever. She always thought of her, filthy mouth. I can't put her on no mess. Dope. I won't say she was on that, but she had a filthy mouth. Well, I have. That's a little of her life, but he her ex.
this far, this storm.
Get warm, but I'm gonna drink as much as I can.
Jimmy Swagger Bible College, spiritually minded, academically sound.
What you need?
From Jimmy Swagger Ministries, it's Bibles for outreach.
Just an impossible.
5 hours long.
Thank you.
today just donated the word. This is Evangelist Jim Swaggart, along with Warren Ross, Dr. David Watts, Dr. Jimmy Dupree, John Rotherstern, and Dave Smith, and you. We're just so happy to have you with us that I want you to know. We're studying one of, if not the most interesting book there are, or at least to me, I've been immensely interesting in the Word of God and the various books of the Bible. But we're studying Romans, and it is the heartbeat of the new covenant. And I've thought of it many times as the greatest book, if you could delineate something of this nature, in the entirety of the Word of God. But whether it is or not, I'll have to leave that to the Holy Spirit. But at any rate, we're going to pick up where we left off on the previous program. The 11th verse.
But if the Spirit,
the Holy Spirit,
of Him,
of God,
who raised up Jesus from the dead, dwell in you.
He definitely does.
He who raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies.
Gives us power in our mortal bodies that we might live a victorious life.
By His Spirit who dwells in you.
We have the same power in us through the Spirit that raised Christ from the dead and is available to us only on the premise of the cross and our faith in that sacrifice. Let me ask this question, please. The Holy Spirit comes into a believer's heart and life at the moment of conversion, right?
That's correct.
He comes in. And He comes in to do a lot of things, but primarily to give us victory over sin. Now, if the believer has his or her faith in something other than Christ and the cross, that limits the Holy Spirit, am I right?
Right.
He does believe.
Right.
Thank God for that. But at the same time, though, he is limited as to what he can do because we have faith in the wrong object.
Right.
Correct?
Correct. Yes.
And what is that object?
Well, it varies from person to person, Brother Swaggart. Obviously, most of the time we get saved and we feel the changes, and they're legitimate. But we look at the changes and we say, oh, that's what I'm doing. And then we start trusting in either the works that we're doing or the experiences that we have. And either one of those things can rob us from the proper direction of our faith.
And that was faith in those things. It's not so much faith that's robbed. It's faith in the wrong thing.
Correct.
Mostly.
I mean, a person who doesn't have their faith in the right object, but who doesn't understand the cross for their sanctification and their justification, they're still saved, and they'll be, still Christian, but they're going to make it a lot more difficult to live for God, and they're going to have a harder time having victory over sin in their everyday life. But
is there a limit to what God will do in forgiving one of that nature that's overcome by sin, and because their faith is in the wrong object, and they cannot have victory like they're going?
When we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to give us all our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But we don't have to live our life in a place where we're just constantly repenting for that same thing that keeps on besetting us time and time again. We can have victory over that, and I think that's what people are missing in their life, is they don't understand this message to where this Spirit that raised Christ from the dead can dwell in us, quicken our bodies to have victory over sin, to where we're not just constantly plagued by the same thing over and over and over again.
Well, still, the fact is, there are some who are plagued by that thing over and over and over again, and have been for years.
Yes.
All right, how many times will the Lord forgive such a one in that capacity?
What did Jesus say? I'll forgive 70 times a day. No, 70 times 7 in a day.
Yeah.
And eternal forgiveness on this would come to
us. I said Peter back on his heel, didn't
it? Yes. Because it was contrary to what they believed at the day. I think one of the things that hurt our faith this week, people first get saved too often. Wherever we're saved, the church or the ministry that we find Christ, we start believing then more than we start developing our faith. So whatever they tell us to believe, if we believe what everyone else says rather than going to the Word of God and learning.
Lotus was a preacher behind a book then.
Correct.
And there are some right now watching us. And it's not just this particular moment, it's that way all the time. That's struggling with a bondage in their heart and in their life in some capacity. And they have struggled, they know it's wrong, it's sin, whatever it might be. And they're struggling with it, trying to have victory over it. They've not been successful. So how do they have victory? Let me explain it this way too. The Holy Spirit, this is what Paul is talking about. The Holy Spirit comes into the heart and life of the believer, and he is God. He can do anything. But when the object of our faith is other than Jesus Christ, and it was that greatly limits him. He does not leave us. He does not say, sir, no, I'm gone. He doesn't do that. He stays with us. Thank God he stays with us. And but still, the problem is ugly.
The challenge is most Christians, and I can take my experience, when they get saved, once we're saved by grace through faith, but then immediately once you're saved, you're issued a bunch of commands to do works by religious leaders or pastors. Do good things. Christ has done all he can. Now it's your responsibility to do all you can. What we end up doing is frustrating the very grace of God, the very grace of God. Paul said in Galatians 2:21, for he did not want to frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the law, Christ is dead in vain. So it may not be the law of Moses, but we set up a regimen of activities or works, and then we try to bring about righteousness or add to the righteousness Christ gave us by trying to overcome the sin pool that we have through good works.
And to have the full brunt against Satan, against the powers of darkness, and the full measure of what the Holy Spirit wants to do for you. Let me put it this way. First of all, you must settle it in your mind that Jesus Christ and Him crucified is the solution. It's the answer. I want to say that again. Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That's what He did at Calvary's cross, was to atone for all sin. I mean all sin. Past, present, and future, at least for those who will believe. And the answer is not in yourself or any other person. It never is. We think it is. The brother just mentioned, we do. I know in preaching and evangelistic work for years, all over around the world, really. And I don't know how many pastors that it brings to mind who almost worked themselves to death. And they were godly men. I won't make that clear, all that I knew. But most would think that that would ensure me.
Blood injury.
But it doesn't.
Yes.
It doesn't. So you need to understand that you don't have any need. Just Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Your victory, likewise, is not in the church. And this comes as a shock to many people because millions are members of churches right now. It's not wrong to be a member of the church.
Actually, I've been coming off a member of
it. But if I'm a member of that church, well, I'm saying that means everything is fine. No, it doesn't. And it has a lot to do with what the pastor preaches or whatever the case, but the church, and I say, and understand that. But when your faith is in Christ and Him crucified, and that conclusively, that totally, completely, Your faith is in Christ and in crucified. Then the Holy Spirit is what Paul has talked about here. The Holy Spirit, who is God,
who can do anything.
What's impossible for us? We've tried whatever that problem is in your life, if there is a problem, and you struggle with it, and everything you can think of, you can pass it until they can almost put you through a keyhole. You try this and that and the other, and it doesn't work. But if your faith is in Christ and you're crucified, the Holy Spirit
knows
to work in your heart to give you victory over that power of darkness. And ladies and gentlemen, it works.
Thank you. Please, yes,
please, what I'm talking about. It works. When your faith is right, when it has the right object, and that right object is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. You hear me say that? I don't limit it to just Jesus. Jesus came to this world to die. And He came to die for the purpose that was to atone for all sin. It was a perfect sacrifice. He never failed, not one single time in word, thought, or deed. All the years of his life living in ministry. And he never sullied himself. He never sinned in any way, shape, form, or fashion. So when he was put on that cross, it was a perfect sacrifice. And it was for you and me. He didn't go there for himself. He could have spoken the word, and the whole nation of Israel would have been paralyzed. But he went willingly to give himself as a perfect sacrifice, which God would accept and God would only accept. We've got to pray. We'll be right back. At this particular time, as you can see, we are studying Great Book of Romans. It is the story of the New Covenant, and it is, I think, the single most important material on the face of the earth. I believe that this book, some 650 pages of the Book of Romans, will help you to understand the New Covenant, the message of the cross. What Jesus there did for us as nothing else will. It sells normally for $40. On sale for just $20 plus shipping and handling. Every believer needs to understand what the New Covenant is. Every believer needs to understand the message of the cross. This will help you to understand it, I think, as never before. And this is Jimmy Swaggart saying, I am waiting for your call.
For more information on this offer, go to
shopchance.com. Don't keep giving, Pastor.
Sacrifice to forgive us of sin, to cleanse us from sin. That was the purpose of it. It wasn't to help us drive a Mercedes instead of a Pinto. That was not the reason for it. It was not that whatever the case, it was to give us victory over the world, the flesh, and the devil. Glory to God. I don't mean sinless perfection. The Bible doesn't teach sinless perfection. But it does teach that sin is not to have dominion over us. For we're not under law, we're under grace. Glory to God. When your faith is right, when you have the right object of faith, it's Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I talked to a man the other day, asked him if you're saved. He said, well, I think I am. And I said, well, why do you think you are? He said, well, he owned one of the largest trucking companies in the world. He had, I don't know, 1,200 trucks, something like that. And he said, I provide employment for thousands of families, and he did. And they have a good living, etc. And they did. If I was working for somebody, I know him, I'd like to work for him. He's a good man. but that wouldn't save it.
Right.
That would not save it. And it's what he did at Calvary's cross and your faith in that that saved your soul and gives you victory. Every one of you right now that are struggling with, maybe with alcohol, with drugs, with gambling, with pornography, envy, jealousy, malice, covetousness, lasciviousness, and one problem after the other, you're struggling with it. And it's dragging you down, and you know it's wrong, you know it's sin. You can have forgiveness for that thing and deliverance from it. You can have it by placing your faith and trust in Christ and what he did for you at the cross and maintaining it in Christ. And what did he do? Like every morning I get up, and I said, you have to do this, I'm just talking about me now.
But I already took the stuff out. Maybe later.
And what you did at Calvary's cross. And it's not in me, neither is it in the church, but it's in you and what you did. And I know a victory today by the grace of God that I've never known before. And I give him the praise and the glory. And there's not a one of you watching right now struggling with something in your life that you can have total and complete victory. Like I say, the Bible doesn't teach sin is perfection, but it does teach that sin is not to have dominion over you. And many of you, I don't mean this critically or unkindly, but I do mean it. You're struggling with sin that does have dominion over you. And thank God, in that case, the Lord doesn't leave you. I just thank God for that. He doesn't leave you. And I just thank God every day of my life that he is merciful. He is gracious. Because there was a day when I'm teaching you, I did not know. I had never heard of it. Never heard of a preacher preaching it. Never read it in a book anywhere. Francis and I, going from church to church all over this land. Every time I would go to a new church on Monday morning, our meetings lasted generally Sunday through sometimes several weeks, and I'd go to the used bookstore, and I would look at the section where they kept the book, used books, and they had some good ones there. Some of those Methodist preachers, some of those Baptist preachers, sir,
yeah,
they were great preachers of the gospel. And I read those books from cover to cover, hundreds of them, through the years. Never read one time what I am teaching right now. Never, I'm not saying somebody didn't teach it, but in all of these books, I never read one single time. And many times some of the sermons were excellent. They were excellent messages.
So Lord, thank you. You don't know, not speak you, but thank you.
Excellent message can still
lead. I still don't know, but still.
And what we're
thank you.
There are stumblings to teach you.
There it is.
You don't have to be suffering bondage. You don't have to be suffering darkness. You don't have to be suffering sin and failure. You can be free in the name of Jesus Christ. But the only way you can be free is what we're attempting to teach you right here, right now, about Jesus Christ and the price he paid at Calvary's cross. There is no other solution, ladies. I'm sorry. There's no other. You can. I marvel at the church that staggers and stumbles from one episode to the other. One time it's laying on her hands, and we believe in that. And the next time it's falling out under the power, we believe in that, but it won't set you free. You'll get up with the same problem you fell down with, unless your faith is in Christ and him crucified.
That's what I was thinking, too.
And, Brother Swaggart, I don't agree with you, because I preacher laid hands on me, and I fell out, and I didn't know anything about what you're talking about. Well, I'll tell you, from now on, we're going to send all of these people to you.
Brother Swagger, you can find a temporary respite after a trip to the altar, after a
very temporary,
very temporary. It's more than just victory over sin, it's abundant life. Abundant life includes freedom from oppression.
Freedom from sin is abundant life.
Right. Freedom from oppression, freedom from depression. When Christians don't encounter the life that we proclaim that they should, and they have doubts and fears about even their own salvation, or maybe, as you said, they're stumbling over and over again. It's the cause of even today, where we see suicides happening in preachers' lives. And it's the fact that this constant flow of the Holy Spirit that can be ours as a result of our simply placed faith, properly placed faith in Christ from the cross.
I talked to a preacher the other day, and I asked him about another preacher that I knew vaguely, didn't know him well, pastor of a very large church.
Someone else kind of looked well, yeah.
He was a very intelligent but he got mixed up in alcohol and drugs, and get the person over the problem.
Yeah, they're byproducts of the problem. They, instead of
having what we shut you down.
Have and what we can have through what the means of simple faith, the process then becomes jaded, and we try to find substitutes for what only faith in Christ and the cross can bring. That's where the problem is.
I asked him, how soon he said, well, it's when he said he committed suicide. And,
Well, I've been asked earlier, what did we do with the Holy Spirit? Would he leave if we continued? One of the most powerful and dynamic testimonies that I've heard in many years is sitting right here with Brother Laura. When he got saved,
it's not a
he was still doing the drugs. He was still drinking.
It's my
He was still smoking. But he was saved.
So it's now that she's speaking.
His heart after Jesus.
But she just found
he was praying. And he was seeking God as much as he knew.
That right,
it certainly is. And again, the renewing of a believer once they're born again, we come to know and depend on what he's done progressively.
Right, so
that's
you
what
can
renewing
do that.
Really is.
No, we interrupted
him. Because it's his testimony.
And
progressive growth of the believer is.
You're about to grow.
That's how I found a good church. But it's the progressive growth of the Holy Spirit. Having freedom in that individual. But he only works as long as our eyes are exclusively on Christ. I did not know the things that you're speaking of, but I was so in love with Christ and so
everybody else my entire he knew what it was. Or what it is. He just ready to put himself on.
Heard what we're teaching.
Right.
Talk about the donor setting free from agency.
Yeah, but
we need to remember what Brother Lauren went through and the results of sitting here goes contrary to what traditional special. But if he got saved, he couldn't be drinking. He couldn't do those things.
Well, there are
God was working in his life.
There are no perfect Christians. We are granted a status of righteousness that's imputed, and then the Holy Spirit is to renew us and conform us into the image of Christ. But he does so based on that person's dependence upon Christ. Now, I can take that testimony and show what God did over the period of a year or 2 years, but within 2.5 years, I was already frustrating that same grace that set me free when I began to learn of teaching that said, you need to change the object of your faith. You need to stop looking at yourself
and start looking at what God's plan is. And that was the beginning of the change. But everyone would fall into that process if they don't hear what they need to hear.
Don't miss the next program. You don't want to miss it. Thank you for being with us today. God love you, and we'll see you next time. The Book of Romans is, I think, one of the greatest books in the entire general Word of God. And it might just be the greatest. These two books that we're offering will help you to understand it, I think, a little better. This one is entitled God's Answer to Fear, Depression, and Discouragement. Every believer
needs
based on the great Book of Romans. And then second, the Great Obligation. Every Christian needs to read this as well.
Now, yes, you are in the world.
But I would advise you to get both of them and save even more money. $25 for both of them. It'll help you to understand.
You probably were sleeping. What you said was true. You were there. Right, take care of the image. Where was they showed them cuffing her? Look at her. Girl, nobody want to look like you in their right mind, in their godly mind. Well, I would say to show them cuffing, but you cut. At least a girl didn't lie.
This is Pastor Gabriel Swagger. We've got a very special music offer. For those of you that enjoy the music of Sunlight Broadcasting Network, you need to take advantage of this offer. Featuring several of our singers. The first one, Daryl Lynn, Daystar.
This you is been stealing with security. They know how.
Randy Knapp's Praising the King of Kings, the Larson family, here we are. Bob Henderson, Glory, Glory, Hallelujah. And then SLR presents Bob Henderson. Each one of these albums is going to fill your heart.
Man, that's a troublemaker, stealing.
And here's what we're doing. Each one of these albums
is going to steal one.
$45. You need to take advantage of this very special offer. Get to the phone, and for this offer, every one of these albums, which are going to be get to the phone. Go online and get this very special music.
You knew Christmas was coming last year. They give me with that.
You probably heard the rumors by now. The rumors
are the birthday was coming, there's no
excuse. It's back, and it's better than ever. There's going to be anointed praise and worship.
Man, there's trouble going in still.
Jesus Christ, workshops for all ages, activities for the kids and the teenagers.
Well, listen to that now.
The last couple of years, our worship baptismal service. Come expecting God to do great things. Come and join us in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, July 24th through the 28th.
Do you have an exposure to study Bible? If you do, you know what I'm
saying. Just answer the question, because we know you can.
It helps one to understand the Bible. Let me say that again. The exposure to study Bible is the Bible that helps one to understand the Bible. It's King James Version. And everybody
who else is on the same scripture? We tell them many without a year.
If you don't have an exposure to study Bible, by all means, you need to get
the Bible. Boy, listen to it.
You fall in love with the Word of God.
He's going to slam the door.
But this is Jimmy Swagger saying, I'm waiting for your phone call. I'm praying that you'll take advantage of this most excellent offer. And I know that you will be blessed.
You only know apologies.
JSM.org.
Now she'll pay for it, Lord. Right, just shut the door off. Take a breath with your mouth going. It's saying nothing but lies. You should have been pleased and not stealing. Girls, we good to listen to that fast talk and understand what you're saying.
Purchase the DVD, Creatures, Patriots, and Providence, Season 2. Go to shop JSN.
Please, sir.
Every Sunday morning, you see us and you hear us read the names of individuals from literally all over the world who are becoming a part of the Family Worship Center Media Church. How do you become a Family Worship Center Media Church member?
He's a student. He had a job. What you feeling for? I don't believe none of that.
And click on the link and we will take care of the rest.
No,
if you enjoy the music, if you enjoy the teaching, if you enjoy the preaching, and you believe that you're receiving your spiritual nourishment from Family Worship Center, then come join the thousands from all over the world that can now say, I am a Family Worship Center Media Church member. When we get your name, we'll read it out and welcome you into the family here at Family Worship Center. Baton Rouge, Louisiana.
Here we are,
Satan
has
relentless in all his ways in an effort to steal the light of every believer. But at salvation, God makes us a new covenant promise. The Holy Spirit goes to work exclusively within the parameters of the finished work of the
cross. Even if you get family bags for money this year, what is
that? Information that is available to all who believe. In the book, How Do I Live a Victorious Life? Brother Spiker offers an in-depth teaching of the power of the cross. To purchase the book, go to shopjsm.com.
Beforehand. I can't feel sorry for you. You almost hit the woman coming out. Almost got in a car accident. She missed the team. Well, if we let her go, she'll be right back here in just a second. Yeah, you want to fight with a major drag. But they drug her. You're not sorry. They give me that mess. About the Monique Clark. Yeah, she was. He took her life. They're literally nothing. They haven't been Christmas tree yet. Let's see. For the insurance money. somebody else in there with the lady there. It's like the dog taking them to him, even though he was gonna find her. He ain't showered or anything. Not that it would matter, Lord. He was going to sit there until the life insurance kicked in for him. Paid out. Let's see.
And it came to pass also on another Sabbath that he entered into the synagogue and taught. And there was a man whose right hand was withered. Luke chapter 6, verse 6. What a blessing it must have been to have heard Jesus teach. And yet, those whose hearts were not right with God found no substance in his words of life, just as those present. That's why Jesus was constantly saying,
"Boy, just a couple of days.
Ear to hear, let it hear." Luke 8:8. There was a man in the synagogue whose right hand was withered. This betrays the entirety of the human race. Spiritually withered as a result of a fall, especially the right hand. Considering that the man, as are most, was right-handed, his activities of necessity would have been greatly curtailed. This pictures the entirety of the human race, which is in the same condition. Concerning this, Paul said, "For the flesh, in this case, evil desires, lust against the spirit."
This is the opposite
of the Holy Spirit. And the spirit against the flesh. The Holy Spirit alone who can subdue the flesh. He does so, as we have repeatedly stated, by our faith being placed exclusively in the cross. And these are contrary one to the other. These two can never harmonize, as Paul has stated. The old nature must be cast out, which the Holy Spirit alone can do, so that you cannot do the things that you would. Without the Holy Spirit, who works by the cross, the believer cannot live. Galatians 5:17. It must be remembered that Paul is speaking here to believers. He is simply telling us that as we ought to, even though we are saved and are new creations in Christ Jesus. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Consequently, we must function laid down by Christ. Unfortunately, the scribes and the Pharisees greatly opposed his healing the man. They were more concerned about their petty rules, which incidentally were man-made, than about the restoration of this man.
I don't even want to look at
this
him, but
this is a perfect picture of religion. Despite their opposition, the Christ of glory told the man to stand up an obvious view of the entirety of the crowd and then told him, stretch forth your hand. The man did so, and his hand was restored whole as the other. That is the only cure for the fallen sons of Adam's lost race. The church, at least for the most part, however, has unfortunately adopted the ways of the world, and I speak of humanistic psychology, in trying to meet this problem. There is no help from that source, even as there cannot be any help from that source. Let all know and realize, no matter how badly withered is the right hand, Jesus can restore it. That's his business.
Thank you, Pastor Donnie.
To one of the expositors, Word for Every Day Daily Devotional, call 1-800-288-8350 from the U.S., 0808-234-4941 from the U.K. All other locations, call 001-225-768-3500. Or get the expositors, Word for Every Day Daily Devotional, online at sunlifetv.com.
Since she walked, well, he was fighting you, so. See you a little bit later. And I didn't want to say sorry. You haven't said sir before. Right, officer. Right. That's okay. And all that, they want some kids to eat. Just foolish, man. Lord, look at him. Sir, you wouldn't see the surgery on the cookie, y'all. And even then, it don't matter because you know it's not sincere. Just a word. No respect. The doctor was right. He was out there all that time with no shoes. Who wants to say, oh, let me get my shoes.
Learn more.
that same day in 758.
Including the message of the cross, Francis and Friends, Family Worship Center music, live services, and
all day we'll be doing Saturday and repeat. Doing it for over a year now, to Lord. Almost a year, right?
because I got balls.
That wasn't my thing.
that every pastor, teacher, every believer can use if they can spare the time. We'd love to have them. And, you know, all of these brothers teaching these courses, they know what they're doing. And, you'll be blessed by being a participant in the process. Dr. Watts, please share your May the 19th. I'll be at Corpus Church in Gayzetta, Texas. That's just west of Beaumont, Texas, so we'd love to see everybody there for the 10 a.m. service at Harvest Church. That's at 301 Idaho Street in Bayzetta, and we'll have more information about that as we get closer. And I do want to also put in a plug that June 6th and 10th will be my class. If you're interested in coming to that, that'll be about how to study the Bible. So we're looking forward to that. Like Brother Larson said, we had good classes last year. Just expect big things this year, so there's the schedule again, and we would love to see you.
Nothing coming up in the near future, but I just want to say we had a wonderful time yesterday at Community Family Church with Pastor Tommy Bates and his congregation, and it was a great weekend, and the Spirit of God fell. We had
here's a piece of work,
Brother Swagger. You came in low energy. You didn't leave church yesterday or on Sunday, low energy. They don't even know what that is. No, sir. No, we had four services. I watched Brother Tommy preach three sermons in a row. And he preached the same text, of course. They've got three different groups that come in. It was a little different each time, but it got better every time. And I was just amazed at how they run things and the level at which they operate. They broke the ground, and he believes, I heard some of the people sharing, they think it might be June or July, but that they start, or at least get the steel in and the frame, and not even close to finishing by that time. But either way, it's exciting to see what God's doing, and the Lord's used it to do. Just a blessed time there, and a great congregation, and a great church. And if you're in that area, Independence, Kentucky, I'm not sure you already know. You'll want to visit Community Family Church. It's a blessing to be there.
Well, we had two great services here at the Worship Center as well, past weekend. And Yana's message was one of the best he's preached in a long time. Sunday night, that character can sing. Yeah. I don't know if y'all heard him or not.
Yes, Preston Tom, yes.
And he can get up and make it.
Absolutely.
You sang with him in Texas.
Yep, I got to sing with him, and you'll know this name, Charlie Blake. And Blake played for you on the organ.
Oh, yeah.
In fact, he
was doing it.
Well, I know he's doing well. He's there in Boyd, Texas, with Brother Ken Harris. And last year we did it was a camp meeting, and Brother Preston Tomlin is staying Sunday, Brother Charlie. And we had a good time, and
he's a good organist.
Oh, to say the least, to say the least. And, but yes, Brother Preston Tomlin is a blessing to the body of Christ, and he can sing. He can sing just about anything. So it's. He blessed our church. I got to tune in and listen to this on the way back.
It's unique. Unique. And I started to sing myself, but I didn't show it.
Well, he said yesterday he used to watch you on Sunday morning and then go in his room and mimic you, try to do what you did. So you've been doing it a while, sir. You're still doing quite well.
What in the world are you talking about?
Don't let it all go to your head. Read the text.
And John is the situation these schools as it regards Israel. Why do they hate Israel so much?
Well, there's an escalation on these campuses across the country. Of course, yesterday the police arrested dozens at NYU. And of course, in Columbia, they were shouting a variety. think it's glory to martyrs was one of their quotations that they heard them saying. They're also saying things that we are Hamas. So they're identifying with Hamas. They're not separating, quote-unquote, innocent Palestinians from Hamas. They're basically claiming fidelity with the Hamas. So it's gone beyond just the humanitarian needs of the poor, suffering Palestinian people to we support what Hamas' objectives are and goals are, and that is to exterminate and kill and eliminate Israel.
They're being honest.
Well, they find they're being honest, but the protests are getting a little more loud, they're getting a little more violent. Chairs are being thrown at some of the police officers that were called in to break it up. They're burning flags, or they're haven't gone into total mayhem, but they're escalating, not de-escalating. So the schools need to do something, brother.
So how much will the law enforcement come up with that?
Well, they arrest them, but then they release them, and the individuals go right back into practicing what they're doing. What's happening in a lot of these college campuses is they're saying that for the police, like Columbia was very upset that the police even came on campus. But the reality is you've got people that aren't even students coming on campus inciting some of these protests. So they're willing to let unlawful people come in and commit mayhem, whereas the police that can keep law and order are not permitted to come on.
But how's the situation going in Israel proper?
Well, last night, Hezbollah launched 35 rockets as Israel began to celebrate the sundown of their Passover, and 35 rockets were shot in. Unfortunately, they didn't cause any great damage. Israel did respond to targeted Hezbollah areas. But yesterday, a report came out from the United States Brothers Fire that was greatly troubling. The name of the report was the 2023 Country Reports on Human Rights Practices. And in that report, it blames Israel. Now, quote, it says, continuing conflict had a significant negative impact on human rights situation in the country. So they're blaming Israel. Now, we're referring to the country of Israel now. They're blaming Israel for all the problems that Israel's having, but they're likening it to what's going on with the Palestinians and the humanitarian issue that they claim is going on in the Gaza Strip. The report goes on to say they have, quote, credible reports, meaning from sources, which are probably Hamas and or Arab sources, of arbitrary, unlawful killing, and forced disappearance, and torture, and cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment or punishment of government officials. So they're blaming Israel for mistreatment of the leadership of Hamas in the Gaza. The same leadership, Sinwar and these others, that called for this event on October 7th that killed scores of people, raped women, chopped babies' heads off. They are claiming that Israel's retaliation is what I just quoted to you in that report. We should be ashamed of whoever created this report for the benefit of the U.S. government to publish something so twisted, so perverted, and so, well, wrong. Wrong is an understatement. This is propaganda that, once again, enforces and creates an environment of hatred towards Israel, not only all over this country, but by those in the Middle East. And it's making it more difficult for Israel. So on one side, we say, well, we support Israel. On the other side, we have so many factions that issue reports and intelligence to the government that are opposed to Israel. It's increasing that.
Well, they have no leadership quality as well. He's going, bouncing from one tirade to the next. The president is.
They're doing everything they can in every way that they can to simply win this election. They do not want to lose the control and majority that they have in the Senate and potentially will have in the House. In fact, I think they have it because so many House Republicans seem to side with Democrats.
But I don't think that what they're doing will happen.
It's helping them. They seem to have the momentum. They seem to have the strength. They seem to have the wherewithal. They got the money that they wanted. We talked about that yesterday. And the Republicans gave in. Now the Republicans have absolutely no leverage against the Democrats when it comes to the border. So nothing's going to happen at the border. It's going to continue on as it does. We're going to see the potential for states allowing individuals to vote in this election coming up. The Democrats, the children of this generation, are obviously smarter than the children of light, the scripture says. They're wiser. They know how to work this system. They've got Trump tied up in ridiculous lawsuits where he cannot campaign. They're making him look bad. They're going to possibly even convict him for jail time this morning. doing everything they can to try to hurt any presumptive of Christianity or conservatism. The point is, this thing can drag out until fall before a decision's made in the courts, and then if he appeals it, it'll be so long gone, it'll be into his term if he is elected president.
Yeah.
Or, you know, it's having an effect on the polls. I wrote a poll that Fox produced this morning showing that Trump fell behind by a little bit on one of the national polls. So people are looking at Trump and thinking, well, maybe this potentially convicted felon, this convicted individual, and this formerly displaced individual.
People really believe that.
They'll believe the lie, Brother Swigert. That's the problem. They'll believe the lie. If you don't hold the truth and righteousness, God said he would send a strong delusion that they would believe a lie. And then they're believing these lies, just like these students. I was watching, you know, from the television cameras that were showing all the protesters last night. You know, you've got a mix of people, Asians, whites, blacks, and Middle Easterners, or those that have that appearance, Latinos, all coming against these Israel with these chants that we are Hamas, that they don't know what they're saying. They don't know what they're protesting. And the reality is, people, because of the popularity of this on campuses, they're coming on board. Professors supporting this in colleges. It's so important for young people today to come to
the professors really are.
Oh, yeah. They are promoting it. Now, here's the thing. They're saying how they're getting rid of these professors. We found at one particular university, none of the professors that were opposed to Israel were let go. The Jewish professors were stopped from coming onto the campus. And so this doublespeak coming from the universities needs to stop. Unfortunately, the owner of the New England Patriots, Mr. Kraft, said he's no longer going to support his alumni Columbia any longer with funds. They've seen enough, they've had enough. And of course, he's Jewish, and I don't think he enjoys watching his very own people get affected by this. If we are to do in this country anything pertaining to the LGBTQ, anything towards the Muslims of this sort, this entire nation would blow up. You'd have police forces, you'd have arrests, you'd have lawsuits. They would not allow this crazy protesting that's going against Israel, against anybody else, and rightfully so. But for some reason, at every level of government, they're permitting this. Mayors in their cities, presidents of their colleges.
Why?
Because, I hate to say it again, but the word hate comes to mind from the Bible. They that hate God have lifted up crafty counsel together to cut Israel off from being a nation. All of that is so true in Psalm 83. They hate God. They don't want to see
Israel
have any semblance of success or even relationship towards God or with God.
Well, how is Israel proper doing? You know what? Because they're very well aware of all of this.
They see the news. In fact, some of the news I get about the U.S., I get from some Israeli news to see what they're getting compared to what we're reporting here. But no, they're getting all this information. I think they're not pleased, but I do think, fortunately, a majority of Israeli citizens know, especially Jewish citizens, I should say, know that most Americans, I say more than 50%, support Israel. These protesters, they're getting all the press, they know that. These colleges, they're making a lot of noise, they're getting a lot of attention, they know that. That's how the evil side works. It tries to get a lot of attention. And sadly, the media is going to give it to them because it's newsworthy. So they keep getting promoted, but the reality is many of us that may not have a platform, what we do here, but many that don't have a significant platform won't have a voice to say much, but they support Israel. And the majority of Israeli citizens, Jews especially, support Benjamin Netanyahu.
Is it a chance that the leadership will conduct themselves as they should?
You say leadership here in the United States? I don't see that happening. I see this administration as evil as can be. I think it's the worst administration this country's ever seen. It's the least supportive of Israel. It's the least supportive of anything that would be considered righteous and conservative and good for the nation. The inflation issues economically, they're destroying this country. The spending has gone radically crazy. The wide open borders, the drugs that are coming into this country, the lawlessness and major cities that are run by Democrat mayors has gone berserk. People have no safety anymore. It's gone to the place, Brother Swigert, unless there's an administrative change coming up this election, we're going to be in great trouble. We're in trouble now, but it's going to escalate. It's going to de-escalate to, or I should say, continue to devolve into something very tragic.
Well, we need to pray.
If God is able.
For Israel. And pray for our leadership as well. The Lord will put a spirit of confusion in their minds. They think as they should. They think to do harm, but to do hurt. And, but you're right, the country's in worse condition. Militarily, socially, economically, than it's been in a long, long time.
But the good news is this. Lauren said yesterday, when the enemy comes in like a flood, God will raise up a standard against it. The standard is the message of the cross.
Right.
The churches will take heed to it and begin to pray, seek the Lord, and turn from their wicked ways. We will see the probability of God intervening and holding back the tide of darkness. But he won't do it so much to save society. He's going to do it so that we can spread the gospel.
You're right. You're exactly right. Dave, pick it up with the 5th chapter of Ephesians, the 28th verse.
So on men to love their wives as their own bodies.
It is proclaimed in this manner because they are one flesh. Even as Paul would say in verse 31.
Who loves his wife loves himself.
Proclaims the oneness of the sacred union of marriage. Now, why did the Holy Spirit go to all the length here concerning marriages, concerning fathers, concerning servants and masters, and so forth and so on? Why do y'all think he did that? Well, considered that it was very important.
Yeah, again, what we're dealing with is submission. It's the 5th of 5 participles that are spoken of, referring to the response or the regular lifestyle of someone who's constantly being impacted by the Spirit of God who indwells, being filled with the Spirit. It's not a reference to Spirit for service. It's a reference to the Spirit's work for transformation, growth, fruit, all of these things that comes with salvation.
Stability.
Yeah, and so the submission is vital because it's a respect for each other as members of the body of Christ, and there's then 3 pairings, the husband and the wife, the master and the servant, the parent and the child. Each is to submit to the other, recognize where they are, and without that submission in the family, without that submission in society, we have chaos. And that's what we can't have. It's what we're seeing, what John was talking about today. There's no recognition of what is right. When men fell, the family was really the first institution that was put into place, and it was needful because of sin. Sin would create chaos, and so there had to be leadership. In all the great organizations that God has ordained, the family, government, and the church, there's submission that's asked for based on a right relationship with God. So husband to wife, and then, of course, in our government, to government or governmental leaders, and then, of course, in the church. And so submission is something that sin and self fight against.
Well, now, some have taken this word submission to links that I think is of Scripture. It's claiming that I know of one incident where an official with a particular denomination demanded that a pastor do something that was obviously unscriptural, and he told him he couldn't do it. I don't know how it turned out, but he told me he couldn't do it. And the man said, well, you do it because I am spiritual authority and you submit to me and I do what.
Proper submission is always for we submit one to another, recognizing the various callings that we each have, the gifts that the Lord has given us. It's a willful, proper submission to each other because we first submitted to God. The idea of this hierarchy, which the Roman Catholic Church practices and many denominations don't practice, it is not biblical. And anything that's not biblical, we as believers should not submit and participate doing.
Right.
Now we're offending ourselves before God. But if you have proper submission to God first and then towards one another, only then can you have proper unity. We hear this term unity being spoken of in many different circles nowadays. We need unity. Unity is not an unconditional getting along and accepting wrongdoing. Unity only can come through an individual that's properly submitted to God first, understanding the call of what God has placed in others. And if they're not following the Lord properly and correctly, according to the Word, we're not to submit to that individual. And that's why if a wife is with a husband who's asking her to do things that are unbiblical, she should not submit to him in that way. Likewise, if a pastor's teaching a particular doctrine or asking an individual to do something that's not biblical, that violates the person's conscience. They will be sinning by doing that if they
didn't do
it, just to obey that individual.
The idea was, I'll be responsible for it if it's wrong, whatever the case. That would work.
No, it does not work.
So this submission is voluntary?
Yes.
It's not forced?
Well, it's not submission if it's forced.
But the wrong kind of submission, yeah. The other thing in this verse is the word love. Christians can have something that nobody else can have. The world doesn't know what godly love is. And the only people that can have that are Christians who allow the Holy Spirit to work in and through them to produce the fruit of agape love. We see eros, which is a sensual, selfish kind of love. We see phileo love, which is a friendship kind of love. And that's the best that the world can come up with.
Right. The agape is the love that we should have.
That can only be produced by the Holy Spirit.
Right. Yeah. In this particular letter, Ephesians, a lot of scholars believe, was meant to be a circular letter to be distributed among different churches. And so Paul, instead of addressing a specific issue, he lays out doctrine in the first three chapters, and then he lays out how to live in chapters 4, 5, and 6. So I think that's one reason Ephesians is such a revered book, because it shows how to live out this new covenant. It shows it in practical ways, like we talk about husbands and wives, parents and children, employer and employee, or slave and master. And so I think that's why these last three chapters go into that and talk about that. And like John said, this submission spiritually in the Catholic Church, they had a hierarchy of everyone, the Pope and the bishops and everyone down, that you could only get the righteousness of God from the priest, you could only get it from the church. But It's a mutual submission. It's not from an authority above me here on earth, but my authority to submit to is Christ. And so when I'm a member of this church, I submit to the spiritual leadership of this church. I don't do my own thing. I don't go off and do something that's against what this minister is about. But this is it's a submission that I put myself under spiritually, but it's not a submission that I would ever violate something in the Word of God. So if any denominational official or pastor or bishop or overseer ever asked a pastor to do anything unscriptural, that would be time. That would, obviously that's not going to work. And then like we mentioned, husbands to wives and parents to children, and the submission has to be within the bounds of what is biblical and what is written. But this would stop all divorces if it was in there.
Johnny,
go
on. I just want to give you a quick example. What I did with my wife in terms of moving here. When the Lord called me, I met you in 1982. Interestingly enough, we were in Philadelphia at a crusade. You were having lunch. I interrupted your lunch, and you graciously asked me to sit down, and we started talking about what was going on in Lebanon with Israel. So our relationship began with Israel and continues with it, discussing it. But the Lord had called at that time to come down to the ministry, but it wasn't the timing to do that. So I delayed it coming. I wasn't disobedient to the Lord, but I waited for the opportunity. I met my wife. We got married. We had two kids. And I knew what the Lord had asked me to do back then in 1982. We didn't move here until 1999. But instead of telling my wife, we're going to move to Baton Rouge, this is what I feel led, I said, Lord, you need to speak to her heart. So that way, she'll come willingly and do so voluntarily. So when we came to the camp meeting in November of 1998, I began to see the Holy Spirit working on her. We had a motorhome parked in the back. We were going to the services. And every day we'd come back, she goes, what do you think of Baton Rouge? I said, I think it's a swamp. What do you think? I was trying to discourage her to see how the Lord might be working on her heart and mind. And finally, after one of the weekend services, she gave action. I really feel the Lord's calling us here. Don't you feel that? Don't you sense that? I said, yeah, I've known that now since 1982. She goes, well, why didn't you tell me? It's because I wanted the Lord to do it. And I said, that was maybe my fleece when he'd speak to you. But that was a willingness for both of us to come down. And then 7 months later, we moved.
But how'd you force the issue?
It may have caused problems, or it might have been like, oh, you want to go? And now, it stopped all pushback, but it allowed me to let the Lord work the timing of it out perfectly. And he did. And as a result of it, of course, the Lord brought us here, and we've been participating in part of this great work.
Well, that's a good little miracle.
No, I'm thankful the Lord called me here. I've learned from all of you so much.
But it's like you mentioned, if individuals would do this, it would stop all divorce. You said this. You said that in marriage relationships, which I say this because it can be applied to the church as well, that we submit ourselves to pastorate, or that we sit under. You said this, that the wife or the husband will oftentimes try to receive from one another what they're only intended to receive from Christ.
Right.
But I want to say this, and I actually want to say it to our local body here at the church, and I want to share it from a sermon you preached on Gideon's 300. You said, I have heard over the years, and I have heard many people come and say, I want to be a part of Family Worship Center to come help Brother Swagger out. And he said, if you are here to help Brother Swagger out, you won't be here long. He said, because pretty soon Brother Swagger is going to do something that you're not too happy with, and you'll leave. The point is this, just as with the marriage relationship, if you're not here because the Lord has had you to be here, there will be something. The point that Paul is bringing out in all of these relationship problems, abandonment happens when we get our eyes on people and they're not on the
Lord.
Every time he gives the command, submit one to another, how? In the fear of God. And then he goes, he doesn't leave the mantra when he gets to servants and masters. Do it with singleness of heart as unto the Lord. So in any one of these scenarios, the key is we're not serving people, we're serving the Lord. And if we'll serve God, if we get the vertical right, then the horizontal will be right. That's what Paul's teaching. Otherwise, and it's tragic, but people will, well, I'm here to help the Swaggerts out. Well, if that's the reason you're here, we are here to help the Swaggerts out. Don't get me wrong. We are here. We've been here since I was in diapers. And even before. But that's not the why. That's not what keeps us going. And for a church to be strong, people have to be strong in the Lord. And he's going to bring up spiritual warfare in a moment. And your fight is not with the devil. It's to submit to God. It's to be strong in him. So if you call that a relationship, it is another scenario where the same applies. We got to receive from something from the Lord, not just from the individual in front of us.
So we had this talk yesterday with the students. Pastor Paris talked about people who say, I want to help out in Crossfire. What can I do? I want to help out in Crossfire. He says, okay, show up at 6 o'clock tonight. No, I want to do something. So he said, okay, show up at 6 o'clock. And well, we'll get you plugged in. And it's really, because like you said, if you're not called to do that, it's, somebody asked me, I'm not an expert on this. I would defer to you guys. They said there's not a message of a cross preaching church in my area. Should I go start one? Well, they asked me. And I said, well, I said, you should start one if God is calling you to start one.
Yeah.
You see the need, and you've identified the need, but you don't need to start one just out of the
right.
idea that you, there needs to be one. Has God called me?
That's it.
And we discussed that the other day, and that was, I was going to bring that up, Brother Larson put that so succinctly. Need is not the call. Are you called to do that? So are you called? Is God? I had a student ask me, how do you have longevity? How do you keep your zeal in ministry? I knew a pastor. He pastored the same church for 52 years. And he said, because I served the Lord. I served under the Lord. And it was difficult at times, hard at times. He loved people. But he was serving this ministry unto the Lord. And that's how he stayed faithful to and obedient to what God had called him to do. And it was a service unto God.
And how many people, going back to the discussion, how many people are trying to get from their pastors, like the marriage relationship, what they were intended to only get from the Lord?
That's, I mean, your completion is in Christ. Your completion is not in another person. I mean, your spouse is a gift from God, and a spouse, I mean, absolutely, but a single person can be complete because our completion comes from Jesus, not from a romantic relationship.
So we see a lot of this in the church. A lot of people are depending on their pastor or someone else in a position of leadership to give them spirituality. You can't do that. It's got to be an individual relationship with the Lord.
Brother Kenneth Hagin stated that he had a problem with farms on the work when he'd been separated. I thought I'm glad he wasn't a doctor. Cross-centered families. across Senate churches and ministries, and if we all have the right optic of faith, have our focus right, and know that our wisdom is not, our faith is not in the wisdom of men, but in the finished work of Calvary, and that's what will transform the church, and that's what will transform everything, is to have that cross in the center.
If anybody would need, it was evidence that the Lord was made available to us because of Calvary. And if we understand that the structure falling in place, we'll be right back. We are beginning a new series on the great book of Ephesians in your Bible. This book I'm holding in my hand will help you to understand that I think it's never before. I want you to listen to this. Jesus Christ is the new covenant. I do not mean that he has the new covenant or understands the new covenant or is in charge of the new covenant, but rather in his person, he is the new covenant. You need to get this on sale now for $15. I would urge every believer to get a copy of it. This series is going to bless your heart, and you need to know all you can about it. And I'll promise you, ladies and gentlemen, it will open up the Word of God to you, help you to understand what we're teaching and what the Word of God gives us. I think it's never before. But this is Jimmy Swaggart saying, I'm waiting for your call. Take advantage of this offer.
We're embarking on a new journey at Jimmy Swaggart Bible College. A journey that's taking us to new heights. A journey that's preparing our students for life. Our message remains the same. Our vision, to take on new challenges. At JSBC, you're not just choosing a college. You're choosing to walk in faith. Our students are preparing for opportunities. Our students are learning how to resolve challenges life brings. Our students are impacting communities throughout the world. And our professors allow the Holy Spirit to guide them. It's our faith that brings us, and our love for Christ that strengthens us. If you have a calling to ministry, a desire to study music, or creative passion for media, then JSBC is the place for you. If you are ready to take that next step of faith, then now is the time for you to take this journey with us. Jimmy Swaggart Bible College. Spiritually minded, academically sound.
Holy Spirit, flow through me, from evangelist Jimmy Swaggart.
Symbolize the union of Christ and the church. And that could
Because they're not aware of it yet, or and we need to be careful how we treat the body of Christ.